Once again, Raymond Arroyo.
Welcome back to The World Over. U.S. policy toward Cuba has been a controversial foreign policy matter for some time. This week, the Trump administration is unveiling a new approach to the communist island nation. Here to analyze all of it and more, we're joined by Washington Times columnist, Fox News contributor, Mercedes Schlapp. Mercedes,
welcome
back. So great
to be here. Thank you.
I want to start with this Cuba policy.
Sure.
Now, the president is not going to close the embassy that President Obama just opened. What do you think is in the offing?
I doubt, first of all, that Congress, is a Republican-controlled Congress, will pay for an American ambassador to go into the doors of the Cuban embassy. But here's the deal. What President Obama has said is that it has this Cuba policy, with this interaction and relationship, cozy relationship between President Obama and the dictator Raul Castro, mm-hmm. led to a very bad deal. It was a weak deal in the words that President Trump used. And so there needs to be a shift. There needs to be a change. There needs to be more demands on the Cuban government, more pressure on the Cuban government. Will it be more free, pushing for free elections, allowing for workers to be able to create unions? Will it be more release of political prisoners, freedom of speech? Basic rights that us as Americans have, Cubans, despite the fact that we've seen this cozy relationship between the United States and Cuba in the last from the last administration, we haven't seen barely any substantial change from Cuba, the island itself, yeah. where you have the dictator still suppressing so
many.
Well,
Secretary of State Tillerson has testified that the change of policy under President Obama actually removed any pressure upon Raul Castro to change or make changes in the nation. He's still arresting dissidents. He's still harassing women. He's still repressing people's religious expression. Will this make a difference when you talk about something like this GAESA, G-A-E-S-A, which is the military-run conglomerate that runs 60% of the businesses on the island? There is talk that the Trump administration is going to say, you can't do business any of these
no more.
But how do you make that happen?
Well, it's one of the greatest challenges of our foreign policy for over 50, 60 years, actually, where no U.S. president has been able to crack the code on Cuba. And mm-hmm. I think that especially when you've had a dictator in place. Now, remember that if the day Raul Castro steps aside or passes away, as we in what we saw with Fidel Castro this past year, it will maybe change a bit of the dynamic in Cuba, but that change has to come from within. And they already have.
From
the people. And the people they're trying to just survive and figure out how they're going to feed their families every day. They're not mm-hmm. thinking about how they can overthrow the government. Now, there are dissident movements in Cuba, but they're weakened because they're either constantly being put into jail, constantly being monitored, and really don't have the accessibility to basically take down a government or push for the people's movement to come into place to take down a
dictatorship. There's this group, Engage Cuba. They did a study, and they claimed if you cut off trade with Cuba in the way the president is talking about, you'll lose $6 billion over 4 years. How can the president do something like this when he's committed to flourish, making the economy flourish and increase trade?
Look, we have sanctions in place against North Korea because of how their government functions. We have mm-hmm. sanctions in place with the aggression in Russia and how they've dealt with the Ukraine. Yeah. I mean, obviously, we have seen this dictator in place in Cuba where people are living under this oppression. And what happens is when you're giving money to the Cuban government. I mean, when you're trying, when this idea of trade with Cuba is more, you're giving money to the Cuban military, the Cuban intelligence officials, the Cuban leaders. Those are the individuals making the money. Little of that money is trickling down to the people. And I think that's what you want is direct trade with the people themselves. And that is something that has not happened, even when President Obama went and had a hot dog with Raul Castro last year at a baseball
game. That didn't cure it?
Absolutely. Yeah, exactly.
Thought the hot dog would have done it.
You think?
You mentioned Russia a minute ago.
It's a Cuban hot dog. It can't be as good.
That's right. Never going to be as good. I like them kosher. Anyway, apparently Russia, for the first time, Russian gas is forgiving all the debts. Something like $30 million worth of debt that Cuba owes Russia. They're going to forgive debt, and for the first time in a decade, they have sent an oil shipment. Are you concerned that Russia is trying to reengage or reinsert its power in the region by engaging
Putin. Absolutely. Let's think about this. The Russian economy can be falling apart. You've seen individuals, dissidents rise up in Moscow, and they're being cracked down upon. Then you also have the fact that they have made their footprint in the Middle East with their relationship with Iran, with their relationship with President Assad in Syria. So what's next for them? Let's move into the region near the United States, which would be, in this case, you'll see this connection with them in Venezuela. You're going to see this connection with them in Cuba. And that's where Russia is. It's where Putin wants to be viewed as the global power. And they want the United States to respect them, especially when they're only 90 miles away from our shores.
Final question. I want to talk about what's been happening here in the Capitol. We've, of course, been talking about my representative in Metairie, in Louisiana, Steve Scalise. Have you ever seen, in the years you've been here, this type of vitriolic hatred where political disagreements have become really sparks for what can only be called civil terrorism?
Yeah, I call it hatred talk. It's a hate talk. It's the fact that you have two parties and individuals that really can't seem to get along. It's like, we can disagree on policy. We might not be on the same page on every issue, but let's treat each other with civility, with respect, with the ability to argue on policy, but not trying to create this division, this hatred. And what's happening is you're seeing it in the social media spheres, which is something that we didn't see in the past.
That's true. We didn't have that.
And you're also seeing it in many of the mainstream media as well, where it creates this environment of just hatred. And guess what? That penetrates into our society. It penetrates into our politics. And I think they need more. Congress needs more God. America needs more God. We need more prayer. We need to find a way that we're more like Jesus in the sense of that we're able to love one another instead of trying to just attack each other all the time.
Yeah, no, the demonization and the dehumanization of certain individuals. I mean, when you're beheading people, whether in reality or in jest, or if you're doing it on a stage, these are toxic images and words that have consequences. And people don't appreciate the power of words and the power of those images. And I think we all have to
recalibrate. And it desensitizes individuals. It's
absolutely.
Like you see the beheaded, bloody head image of President Trump, and people are cheering that image. And you're basically saying, wait a second, there's something wrong here. We're talking about the President of the United States. And we need to talk about that. All of us, it's not about our political parties. We're all Americans. We all want what's for the betterment of this country. And we might disagree on how to get there, but it doesn't mean we have to go after the individual themselves.
Mercedes Schlapp, thank you as always for being
here.
Great
to be here.
You can find Mercedes' insightful commentary at WashingtonTimes.com.